strategy leaders that have joined us. Courtney?
Yes.
And Pat? Or is it Patrick? Whatever. And Regina? So, Courtney, could you give a little background on yourself, 2 minutes, and what makes, end up with what makes Somerville, what makes Union Square, Union Square?
Good evening, everyone. My name is Courtney O'Keefe. I live in Magoon Square. I'm the interim executive director of Somerville Local First. I'm a former alderman here in the city of Somerville from Ward 5. I'm on various committees, which will eat up the 2 minutes that I have to introduce myself. For me, what makes Union Square is only one of the words, and that's union. It's the uniting, it's the collaboration, it's the togetherness, it's the fact that people can own a gym right next to people who own a coffee shop right next to somebody who wants to fix radiators, and right by a gentleman who owns a really beautiful flower shop. And that's how I've always seen Union Square. Think in closing, the rest of my 2 minutes, I'm single. I like long walks on the beach, pina coladas, so. Thank you.
I apologize in advance, I'm not that funny. Patrick McMahon, I work for Federal Realty Investment Trust over at Assembly Square. I'm on the development side and have been in development in the greater Boston area for the past 20 years. I also serve on the board of directors at the Planning Office of Urban Affairs. That's the Archdiocese of Boston's Affordable Housing Development Group, as well as the board of directors for Heading Home. Heading Home is a nonprofit that provides both shelter and social services to formerly homeless individuals and families. What makes Union Square unique? Was that the question? You know, I in the RFQ process and in one of the design charrettes I sat through, I heard someone say, so now I'm plagiarizing, but I'll give credit to whoever said this. Person got up and said that they liked to cook and that Union Square, though, was not so much chicken noodle soup, but rather gumbo. And I thought that that was a fantastic way of describing Union Square. It captures the multiple layers, the union of those multiple layers coming together to produce something that I think most people love, gumbo or some variation of gumbo. So that's what I think makes Union Square Union Square.
Regina.
The name says it all. My name is Regina Bertholdo, and I work for the Somerville Public Schools. But I'm here as a resident. I'm a Somerville resident. In what is my connection with the Union Square? What is it?
What's your connection? You live here, you work here, why are you interested?
All of the above. And I, my connection with Union Square is what I see it's happening. So I'm Brazilian, and many years ago we had lots of Brazilian shops and on Union Square, and they are little by little, a lot of them have already disappeared, and I am afraid that we're losing the flavor. We do have a fabulous diversity in Union Square. However, it has brought up to a higher level. And I think that people that made Union Square so successful in the past is not being allowed to be there because everything is more expensive. So I miss the old Union Square, and we want to make sure that we keep a mix of what we had and what we have now as well.
Chris, before we move on, I'd also just like to...
Chris of Goddess.
I'd also like to just acknowledge Alderman Niedergang from Ward 5, who has also joined us. So thank you to Alderman Niedergang. I don't see any others in the room just yet, but I'm sure we will see them throughout the course of the process.
So, to everybody else who's here, are there questions? We have George here. Oh, and the interpreters, Could the interpreters...
Sorry, you're eating. Would you mind coming up just real quickly and introducing yourself?
Just in case there's some interpretive services we need.
Boa noite, eu sou a Adriana, estou aqui para fazer um português e vou te ajudar. Amém?
Thank you, thank you. So, anybody have any questions, particularly about, just general questions about the neighborhood plan and about the fiscal impact? Please, and come up to the podium and name, rank, serial number.
Hi, I'm Tim Talon. I live on Prospect Hill with my family. I'm also part of the Square Neighbors Group. I think one of the benefits of the neighborhood plan as a master plan for Union Square, and this process as well, is the chance to think comprehensively about Union Square. So not just building the Irish, not just the redevelopment of ourselves, not just any specific property, but the whole square. One of the things about the neighborhood plan, the plan that's been developed so far, is it shows a full build-out of the redevelopment blocks and a board of merits, but no changes to the rest of Union Square. We know that most of the development that's taken place so far has taken place in the existing fabric of the square. So I guess two questions. One, should the plan be updated to speculate on what development may hold for the existing fabric of the square? Because George, you mentioned that this plan wouldn't be the basis for the redevelopment and zoning that's in place, the changes that take place. And I think there needs to be a basis for that redevelopment. The second is the fiscal impact analysis. If that includes development elsewhere in the square that's not shown in the plan.
Both very good questions, and thank you. I would ask that you particularly take the point about development outside of what we call the D blocks, the T blocks in Boynton Yards, and post that somewhere in our written comment section, either on open comment or in an email to us, so it's like in our set comment points, because it's a good point. I think that to some extent there are some possibilities, and maybe we haven't specifically picked them up in the plan. Some vacant lots, some small lots, some infill stuff here and there that could potentially occur outside of those D blocks, Boynton Yards, and T blocks. I do think it is more limited than what we've been seeing before. One of the goals of Summer Vision was to shift more development to transformative areas. And as you look in the core of the square, well, the core of the square is what the plan calls an enhanced area, so it does imagine some changes. It is also an area that has a pretty significant historic fabric, something that we've been looking at carefully. We're doing a study now on historic structures around there to determine if there are, we had one of the drawings in the plan that I did show today. We have a marking off of certain structures that we know we don't want to change, and I want to make sure that we find a strategy that makes sure we preserve the things we want to preserve, while at the same time, if there is incremental small-scale infill development in certain other spots, we have an understanding of what that is and where that is. But there's certainly the character of like the retail on Somerville Ave, the intent is not to really be building up there because Union Point Yards is better able to address it. The areas we've marked as fabrication district, like those little garages behind Bow Street or the Fringe Union site or something like that, we're determined to try to keep those in creative industry rather than in a redevelopment strategy. So we're looking at all of those pieces to try to make sure they fit together. To the extent that we may not have identified some things that may turn over deeper into the square, we can take a closer look at that. I want to make sure to catch that. Shorter answer on the on the impact study. The impact study measures the fiscal impact of the total development that's on that last page of the plan draft, which is basically the D blocks, the T blocks, point and yards. That's pretty much it. So if something happens, you know, three blocks away in from D7 on Somerville Ave, it's not anticipated in the fiscal impact study. Sure.
I'm Tori Antonino, Somerville resident, community road in Somerville. My question involves, we want to create jobs and jobs that are
I hope this is that. Statements, not if you guys ask questions, you should take this microphone.
Okay.
It's about job creation and good jobs. And I was thinking that could we have some sort of an ordinance that says all the new jobs in this area have to be livable wages, similar to that of the contractors that the city does hire. There's a, I don't know what it's called, but like anyone who works for the city, any contractors that are hired have to have a livable wage. And this could ensure that the jobs, you know, aren't just minimum wage retail jobs. So I would like that to be considered. And my second part of this question is actually about retail. I really don't want Union Square to become like Harvard Square. I don't want, we talk about that first floor retail. I would really prefer to see, have Somerville be a place where, or why do you go to Union Square? You don't go to Union Square to buy stuff. You go there to learn. You go there to go to the work bar. You go there to go to the kitchen to figure out how to, maybe there's the Somerville Learning Center, a dance center, a small movie theater. I just want to get away from the fact, the emphasis that we need retail on the ground floor. I'd really much have Union Square be a place to learn and be creative. So those are my 2 points. Thanks, George.
And both, I think, very good points to keep in mind as you think about both the public benefits process and the plan. And again, I would ask you and anybody else as you have these ideas to also put them into the plan writing comments. I just want to say, I do not know the answer to the question of whether or not we have the legal capacity to do the steps about living wages beyond city contractors. I just don't know. But put those comments out there and make sure they stay in the discussion. I have two more hands in the back from the public. I'll come to you, towards you with this microphone as much as I can.
Nancy Barron, Director of Movie Rogers. I own property in Union Square. I work in Union Square. Is there any way we can have residents of Somerville get job priorities for the new jobs that are created? Instead of outsourcing it.
Hi, my name is Ilona Tierney. I'm peer coordinator at Ruby Rogers, and I would just like to give people a little bit of insight of what we do. We are an outreach program to the city's neediest people. We have homeless people, shelter people, other people of all different types, and we try to help them all. And the last thing I'd like to say is our motto is, our disabilities do not define us. Thank you.
Hi, it's Ed O'Donnell again. One of the things that I do want to point to is when the original RFQ for a master developer was issued in December of 2013, we talked about some of the benefits that we would anticipate might arise from the redevelopment of the square. And one of those things that we stated was we would expect and hope that the master developer and their tenants would work with us in terms of